What's up, guys? Vulcan here, and today we're back in Outriders, this time with a heavy dose of tips and tricks for all ranges of players so you guys can hit the ground running at launch. So I'm gonna break this video down into a few parts. There are timestamps at the bottom for each category so you can quickly find what you guys need. Or if you come back to the video, you don't have to remember where you saw that particular thing. Hopefully you can just click on the category and find what you're looking for. So to kick things off, let's break down some basics that makes things a lot easier in Outriders. First up, we're talking classes. Now, there are four classes in Outriders, each bringing something unique to the table. The Devastator is a beefy tank class that specializes in punching enemies in the mouth and applying bleeds to everything. The Pyromancer is a whirlwind of fire and chaos that ignites enemies up close and at long range. Now, this class is able to dish out massive amounts of damage, but also has a more complicated healing mechanic, which we'll cover shortly. The Trickster is a time-jumping ninja that can slow down time to trap enemies and teleport all over the map to dish out big damage and then disappear. This is also the only class that can naturally generate an extra shield to give health a little bit of a buffer. And lastly is the Technomancer. Now the Technomancer is a jack of all trades that can summon turrets and it can materialize weapons from mid-air. The Technomancer also possesses the only healing skill in the game, plus they can freeze enemies in their tracks or spread poison to groups of enemies. So now we know all about the classes, let's go ahead and let's talk healing. So when it comes to Outriders, the only thing you need to know is you're not going to be popping potions or using healing spells to restore health outside of the Technomancer. Instead, you have to kill enemies a certain way to regain health and keep yourself in the fight. So the Devastator is going to heal whenever you kill something up close. That's it, simple and effective. The Trickster is the same as the Devastator. You kill things within close range and you regain health, but you also gain some shield to give yourself a little bit more of a buffer because the Trickster has less overall armor than the Devastator. The Pyromancer is going to regain health whenever a marked enemy is either killed by yourself or an ally, and you can mark enemies whenever they're hit with one of your skills or your melee ability. Now the Technomancer has increased weapon and skill leech, so they're going to regain health whenever they deal damage. And this is a straight vampire mechanic. It's the easiest to manage, and I feel like if you're a new player or someone who really wants to take the game easy, the Technomancer's healing is going to be the easiest to get a handle on. Now when you're looking at an enemy health bar, you're going to see a skull with a green medical cross, and this is how you know that you will receive healing from that enemy when they die. Changing gears a bit, another thing you need to understand is how melee works in Outriders. Each class has a melee ability that will interrupt and apply a status effect to enemies. Now, if you melee while standing still, you're going to hit everything in a cone in front of you. If you use it while sprinting, you'll leap into the air, hit the ground, and deal damage to everything in an area around you. Now, the interrupt here is the critical part because you can easily stagger enemies and keep them from casting. This is incredibly useful for bosses and elite enemies when they keep trying to cast resurrection or healing skills. The next thing I want to talk about is a small call out, but it's something that's really easy to miss and could be pretty important for your build. On each class skill tree, there are nodes that are going to increase damage of certain weapon types, which is great, but they also increase the drop chance of those weapon types. So if you're playing a Devastator and you really like having a shotgun and playing a shotgun style build, then you want to take the Shotgun Master node. It's going to increase your shotgun damage, but it also increases the drop chance. Now, let's say you want to have a sniper rifle for your Technomancer, same thing. You take the Sniper Master node, it increases your sniper damage, but also gives you a higher chance at sniper rifles dropping. Now, this is a small thing, but it's important to building a playstyle and something that you can easily miss if you're just trying to fly through the tree. The next thing I want to talk about are loot and inventory tips. So one of the biggest features the game doesn't tell you about is the auto loot feature. Now, this feature will automatically pick up all of your loot when you either die or leave an area, and this is extremely handy for farming or making sure you don't miss any items. You can also manually activate this by pressing H on your keyboard or the down arrow on your controller. Now, auto loot is going to transfer all of your items to the stash if your inventory is already full, which is great. Now, if everything's full, your stash plus your inventory, then that gear would become automatically scrapped, so please keep that in mind. The developers have heard some criticisms on this and they are keeping an open mind, but don't expect any big changes in time for launch. On top of that, legendary drops will also appear as a star on your minimap. That way you can easily tell if one dropped and you make sure to go over and pick it up, or to at least manually click auto loot. That way you have it in your inventory. Now, speaking of your inventory screen, there are a few things the game doesn't tell you in here as well. Now, when you hover over an item, the game will tell you if you have a mod unlocked and what type of items you'll get from breaking it down. So if you're looking at an item and you see a 4-square box, that means you already have that mod unlocked and it's added to the catalog and you can use it from the crafting window. If you see a red mod and a cloned box, that means you have a duplicate mod equipped already and you will not receive benefits from equipping that item. Now, when you're looking at attributes on an item, you'll see this symbol next to one of them. This means that whenever you break this item down, you're going to get an anomaly shard for that particular stat that can then be used for crafting. So if you want to raise an attribute, you need to have a shard in order to raise that attribute. We'll cover that momentarily. Now, when you're dismantling items, if you hover over the dismantle button, you can see what you're getting from breaking those items down. You'll be able to see all the mods, the shards, and the resources in here, and it kind of gives you a nice little overview of what you're going to be getting by breaking all of this stuff down. Now, another big tip is what to sell and what to dismantle, because there's so much gear in this game and you need to kind of balance out your currency and your resources and your crafting items and your mods. So what you want to do is sell all of your white and green gear for money, right? You're not really going to get a ton out of those besides some shards, but honestly, that's not really important early on. So make sure to sell all of those things and then break down anything blue and higher to unlock the mods, collect resources, and the shards that you need for crafting. So as you play the game, you're eventually going to unlock all of the tier 1 mods, and then you can start selling blues if you want to. So this really helps balance out your resources for crafting and your money for buying things from the shop. Now, I've referenced crafting a few times, so this is the one system that we didn't get to see in the demo. Now, luckily, I was able to test it out during a gameplay session for creators. So here are some tips to kind of get you guys started. So crafting lets you customize just about anything on your gear. You can do things like increase your level, rarity, attributes, you can swap variants. So there's quite a few different things you can do with these pieces. Now, swapping variants is the one that I often get questions about. What exactly does that mean? It means you can change an assault rifle from full auto to burst to semi-automatic. And with all of that, all of your base stats will change. Like going from full auto to semi-auto will increase range and accuracy, but it'll lower your fire rate. And you can do this multiple times, so you can constantly kind of switch it between variants, really kind of get a feel for what you like and what you don't like. And you can also swap out mods on gear. However, once you change a mod, the other mods on that item will lock and cannot be changed. So you can only change the same mod that you've changed previously. Now, overall, a good rule of thumb for crafting, save all your materials for endgame. The gear you're going to get while leveling isn't going to be valuable after a few hours, right? You're most likely going to be at a higher world tier at that point, and since gear is stuck to the tier it dropped at, you're going to be dumping resources into an item that's less valuable. So make sure to save everything for endgame, and then once you hit expeditions, that's when you can start investing heavily into your gear so you can push deeper into expeditions and hopefully get to the point where you can have a nice build and unlock that Eye of the Storm. So switching things up a little bit, we're going to talk about the UI and the HUD. So Outriders does give some pretty good options to customize your heads-up display and change some of those options to make things easier for those who have any visual challenges as well. If you're someone who struggles with small text, you can change the font size in options from small font to large font. If you prefer a higher contrast on the UI, you can change that in options as well to go from a light gray that they have to a black. If you want to remove all of the enemy health bars, for example, you can do that in the HUD options. Here you can remove all of the HUD or certain pieces to suit your playstyle. I know a lot of people are, I don't want to see damage numbers, I don't want to see enemy health bars, I don't want to see my skills, I don't want to see all of this stuff. I just want a classic kind of third-person shooter. You can totally do that. Go in there, disable the things you don't want to see, enable the things you do want to see, and really customize the game and be able to play it how you want to play it. Also, if you press tab, you'll be able to pull up a guide for your objective to help kind of get you from quest to quest. That's another thing that isn't exactly blatantly obvious, but it's something that's helpful at times. Now, in combat, there are a couple of things that the game doesn't tell you that really change the way you play. First, you can swap shoulders by clicking the right thumbstick on that controller or on the scroll wheel on PC. Now, second, if you have a skill that you can throw, like Scrapnel for the Technomancer, you can hold the skill button and it'll actually pull up a telegraph so you can aim that skill a lot easier. Now, lastly are the status ailments. Now, there is a lot packed into how these work, how to remove them, and how they work for players. So we're gonna dive into this really quick because this is something that's pretty important. As a high overview, status effects are negative effects that are sometimes applied through weapons, abilities, and melee attacks, and there are 8 total effects that can affect both the player and enemies. Now, the first two are crowd control effects, Ash and Freeze. Now, Ash is gonna stop an enemy for 2.5 seconds, and Freeze is going to stop an enemy for 3.5 seconds. Now, players can break control of any crowd control effects by using their melee ability. So if you get frozen or if you get stopped and covered in Ash, you can use melee and you'll break out of that and you can continue moving or running. This is incredibly important, especially when you're fighting elite enemies, because they're gonna freeze you and then they're going to kind of combo skills off of you. Like getting frozen into a fire tornado is a bad time. So you wanna make sure you break out of those crowd controls and continue moving so you can stay alive. Now the next three are damage over time effects, bleed, burn, and toxic. So bleed is gonna cause enemies to take damage over time equal to 2.5% of your ability power every 0.5 second for 5 seconds. So that's 10 total ticks of damage going out onto that target. Now players can avoid taking damage from bleed by standing still. Simply don't move and you're not gonna take any damage or you'll take reduced damage. If you do move, you're gonna take more damage. So make sure to stand completely still. Now, burns are gonna cause enemies to take damage equal to 3.7% of your ability power every 0.5 second for 6 seconds to a total of 12 ticks. Now, here is going to be pretty interesting because burn actually deals the most damage over time of all of the ailments. So pyromancers out there and people who are stacking up burn damage on their weapons and gear, you're gonna be doing a significant chunk of damage over time compared to bleed and toxic. So players, you guys can remove burns by rolling. Simply stop, drop, and roll. Practice what we all learned when we were growing up and you will completely get rid of burn and avoid taking damage. Now, the last one is called toxic, and this one's gonna cause enemies to take damage equal to 3.5% of your ability power every 0.5 second for 6 seconds for a total of 12 ticks. Now, toxic is a little bit unique because it can only be removed when you receive healing from yourself or a teammate while you're afflicted. So you can't dodge, you can't roll, you can't run or stop or whatever. You have to physically kill something to heal yourself using whatever healing mechanic you have, or have a technomancer activate their healing skill to purify you. So if you plan on running a support technomancer, make sure to keep that healing skill on your bar. That way you can keep everybody topped off, but also dispel toxic. Now the last three effects are called vulnerable, weakness, and slow. Now vulnerable will cause enemies to take 25% increased damage for 10 seconds. Weakness will reduce the damage a target deals by 30% for 6 seconds. And slow is going to reduce the movement and attack speed of an enemy by 30% to 75% depending on the target's resistance, and the duration is going to be determined by the skill or mod that's used to apply the slow. So overall, players can't avoid vulnerable, weakness, or slow, right? But they can reduce the effects or even become immune to those status effects through mods. So I can see stacking up a resistance to vulnerable is going to be incredibly important for those deeper expedition runs. So now we've been over all of the different effects, there are some things you need to know about if you want to rock an affliction build or if you want to rely on status effects for your overall damage. So rule number one, only one player can apply a certain status effect on an enemy. So for instance, if player A applies poison or toxic to an enemy and player B applies poison, it does not stack. It just refreshes that duration. So with that being said, you can stack something like blighted rounds and have a bleed mod to apply both toxic and bleed to the same enemy. You just can't stack 2 instances of toxic. Rule number two, elite enemies will build a resistance to status effects and can become temporarily immune to crowd control effects like slow, ash, and freeze. So you can keep an eye on this by checking if the enemy has this blue swirl icon. If they have it, they're going to be immune. Now, rule number three, these statuses can also affect players, right? We've talked about that. So keep in mind, you can be frozen, you can have your damage reduced, and because of that, you need to keep an eye on your debuffs and also look at mods that are going to give resistances to certain things. You don't want to stack all offense all of the time because that makes for a one-dimensional build and will leave you extremely vulnerable to status effects and crowd control effects. So last up, I want to talk about some quest and leveling tips and tricks. So the first is that side quests can be repeated at any world tier to get better loot. This was confirmed and updated during the demo to help those wanting to farm legendaries without murdering a captain a million times. You can go and continuously spam these side quests for a chance at some legendary gear. Now, another thing you're going to see in the full game are hunts, and these are missions that where you're going to chase down a legendary beast, kind of like Monster Hunter. These are retroactive, so if you kill a monster in the wild without the quest, you can still go back and turn it in. So don't feel like you're missing out or you have to constantly be stacking your quest log with things to do. So this wraps up my list of top tips and tricks that I thought would be incredibly helpful for you, but I want to hear from all of you guys. So what tips and tricks would you tell a new or a veteran player? Is there one that you didn't know about in the list? Is there one that I missed that you think is just like, Vulcan, this is so incredibly valuable, you should have had this in there? Let me know in the comments section below. But as always, this has been Vulcan, and I'll talk to you guys next time.